So in South Dakota, we are very lucky to have a governor that is so supportive of agriculture and everything that affects it. And so therefore this morning, I am so excited and pleased to welcome Governor Dennis Stuggard, who will be moderating our next panel, focusing on an issue that has become a large part of the conversation in our state, pollinators. So please welcome me, help me welcome Governor Dennis Stuggard and our panelists.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the pollinator panel. They found this barrel and they were scraping the bottom of it, and they found me to moderate this panel because I am not an expert on pollinators, but I am interested in it, and I hope you all are. And to the extent that this panel can help spark or grow that interest, I think it'll be worthwhile. So thanks for joining us this morning. Some of you know that I grew up on a farm in southeastern South Dakota near Del Rapids, kind of between Del Rapids and Garrettson. And we had a very small farm when I was growing up, just a quarter section. And my two sisters and I and our parents had cattle and hogs and chickens, and we raised corn and hay and soybeans and oats. And on a quarter section farm, that tells you we had all kinds of small plots around the farm. And back in those days, I can remember as a boy going down to the waterway. We had a waterway on one corner of the farm and then another waterway on another corner of the farm. And the lands adjacent to those waterways and within the waterways were native plants. They were all native plants. And many times there would be a wet spring when we'd never get that planted at all. There were areas, of course, which we never had planted and never intended to plant because it was just too wet. And I remember as a boy going down there, and there'd be frogs down there, there'd be milkweed, there'd be all kinds of flowering wildflowers and forbs and native grasses. And then as farming evolved, of course, through the years, there's less and less of that land on our property. Drain tile has been installed in some places, and with modern farm equipment, you sometimes end up farming areas that really aren't productive to farm just because it's easier to go right through it or go right by it and farm it. And so, of course, and then over the years, in some ways, if you get a dry patch, a dry year, you might farm a little closer to that waterway or into that waterway. And some years then the waterway became very narrow. And then when we experienced some erosion from that in the wetter years, we realized, gee, now we cut that corner a little too short. And so we ended up reinstalling a contoured waterway, which of course was not native grass anymore. So I guess the point I'm making is over the years, that little microcosm of the quarter section that I grew up on, and we still have, my two sisters and I still own. In fact, that's where my house is when I'm done being governor and done with subsidized government housing. Then I'll move back to that farm and move back to our house there. But that microcosm of what occurred next to the waterways on our farm, multiply that times thousands of acres across South Dakota, and that loss of native grasses and forbs and wildflowers, multiply that by thousands across our state, and that's what's happened really to our environment across South Dakota. Nothing wrong with that, but it's a fact of life. And so as the habitat that supports pollinators has declined, so have the pollinators. And pollinators play an important role in agriculture and in our habitats. You know, it's estimated that a third of the food and drink that we consume in the world is made possible because of the work of pollinators. In other words, if we don't have pollinators, we don't have food. We don't have production. The flower will not turn into the fruit or the seed or the plant. 3/4 of the world's flowering plants and about 35% of the world's food crops depend upon pollinators, live pollinators. Birds, bees, bats, insects, other kinds of pollinators that help a plant produce something that's edible. More than 3,500 species of bees are among these important pollinators. And so, of course, they're essential for all crops, but the one crop that they in turn go back to the hive and make, honey, is also a crop in South Dakota. We're a top honey-producing state. We're often number two, usually number two and number one, I think, is North Dakota right now. This year, we rank second in the nation for honey production. We've produced more than 14 million pounds of honey in South Dakota. And I'm sure you've seen those white beehives all over the state as you drive around. But as I mentioned earlier, pollinators are not just limited to bees in colonies in those white boxes you see around the state when you drive around, but they also include wild bees, butterflies, birds, bats, all kinds of insects end up pollinating crops as they move around and explore the flowers of the plants. And of course, those pollinators depend upon a mix of of wild grasses, of forbs, of flowering plants of all sorts, so they can live. And if they don't live, of course, they can in turn pollinate our crops. So knowing the importance of pollinators to agriculture, the Lieutenant Governor and I have been interested in this and we've been trying to encourage the reestablishment of more pollinator-supporting habitat around the state. So we've been working with some of our state agencies. Game Fish and Parks, as you know, has many game production areas around the state. And when you think of game, you often think of, you know, pheasants or other kinds of wild birds or maybe deer. And they also count on insects that rely upon pollinator plants. And so again, by introducing pollinator plots, you can also enhance wildlife production. So game production areas increasingly are being planted to pollinator supportive crops and mixes. And so what used to be just a plain grass pasture, we're trying to convert some of those areas into a mix of more wild plants, including wildflowers and other pollinators. Also, the Department of Transportation, we explored, can we plant pollinators along the interstate somewhere? And I thought that'd be a great idea. Now, one problem with that is, of course, you have to recognize that mowed areas don't catch snow. Vegetated areas do catch snow and create drifts. So you can't do it right next to the road, but maybe up along the height of the opposite ditch on the south side, because most of the wind drifting occurs from the north. Maybe on the south side up against the fence. Well, we looked into that, and the way the interstate roads were built in South Dakota, the adjacent landowner still owns that property and has the right to, first right, to take the grass and hay it. And so we realized that's not going to work because it'd be too much trouble to, it would cause too much difficulty for the adjacent landowners. And we just don't have the ownership interest that the state as an entity would otherwise have. On the two-lane highways, we are starting to experiment with some strips, again, adjacent to the fences, far enough away from the road itself so it wouldn't cause drifting. And you may have come across some two-lane roads where we're starting to plant and experiment with pollinators. The other place where you'll see it, beyond the game production areas and beyond the areas adjacent to two-lane roads, is in some of the rest stops on the interstate. Some of the rest stops, when they were created, were planted with bluegrass. And they've been mowed and mowed and mowed. And so we wanted to cut down on the cost of mowing and also increase pollination if possible. So you may see some of our rest stop areas or any other surplus lands that the Department of Transportation holds being converted to pollinator plants. So the point I'm making is the state, at my request, is making some moves toward this, and I'm hoping that we can continue to do that. And I know, though, that we as a state can't do this alone. The impact that we will have as a state can help, but we need others to help. We need private landowners like me and like you, non-government organizations, federal agencies who own federal lands. We need everyone to pitch in a little bit to help restore some pollinator habitat in South Dakota. We know, for example, the monarch butterfly is in decline, and there is some concern at the national level that it may decline to the point where it's placed on the endangered species list. And when you have a species that's put on the endangered species list, that prompts a lot of federal law to come into play and impacts us in ways that we don't want to be impacted. So if we can prevent a species on the endangered species list, it helps gives us more freedom of action with our lands. So it's important that we try to avoid that, and we're also working to do our pollinator crops or plants to encourage milkweeds in areas where they're not going to hurt adjacent cropped lands, but provide milkweed locations so, again, monarchs can be kept off the endangered species list and give you continued freedom on the properties you are farming. I want to do my part. My two sisters and I, as I said, still own the quarter section where we grew up. I own the 7-acre building site, because Linda and I bought that from my parents when they were still alive, and we built our own house out there. And then my two sisters and I inherited the rest of the quarter, and we had a meeting last year with a habitat advisor, and I think one of the panelists will probably describe some of the advisor help that any of us can get, because there's all kinds of programs. There's federal programs, there's state programs, there's Pheasants Forever programs, Ducks Unlimited programs, and we can't be experts on all these programs. I mean, you're busy farming and ranching, and you can't be an expert on habitat programs, but we can have experts on all of those programs that are available to you. So you can just say, here's my goal. And so I'll just give you an example. My wife Linda and I, my sister Joyce, my sister Sandy, all were home at the farm about a year ago, a little less than a year ago. And we called up, we went online, Habitat Pays website, and you can just enter those two words in your browser, Habitat Pays, and I hope our panelists will be talking about that again too. And you can find a list of advisors all across the state, and each of them is assigned to a certain area of the state. So there's an advisor that's assigned to your area of the state. You can call up Joe or call up Mary, and in this case, the advisor, and I can't remember his name honestly now, he came out to our farm on a Saturday morning and met with Joyce and Sandy and Linda and I, and talked about our land, and he had aerial maps of the land, and so he said, you know, we'd like to put in some pollinator plants in this area. And it's not going to be a huge thing because we still are planting corn and soybeans on, you know, the vast majority of the property. But there are areas now where we know from the combine maps that it's not profitable to farm these areas. In fact, we're losing money farming these areas. And with precision ag and the combine maps that are available today, and especially as we're pressured with profitability margin being as skinny or non-existent as it is today, how foolish it is when we're losing money to farm land that makes us lose even more money. So what we want to do is be smart farmers, smart ranchers, and put into some kind of program where you can get some positive net income from it instead of losing income by farming it, wasting seed, wasting fertilizer, wasting gas when you're going across it with your tillage equipment. So instead, consider using some of those non-profitable areas or others if you just feel like you want to have some more wildlife and nature, and convert those to some pollinator habitat. So Joyce and Sandy and I are going to be doing that. We're going to be hopefully planting it next spring. And again, it's not going to be, it's not going to be even 10 acres. It's going to be 5 or 10 acres probably is what we're going to do. But it's something out of 160. And it'll bring us back to those days that we used to have when we probably had about 10 acres like that on our farm. And we'll have those 10 acres again. So anyway, that's kind of the way I look at it. And that's why I'm interested in being part of this panel this morning. And I am very excited about our three presenters. I'm eager to hear from our panelists who are going to talk about habitat assistance, kind of things that they know of, what they've been using or offering. And with that, let me introduce our panelists. First, here to my left, we have Matt Morlock. He's the acting director of Pheasants Forever, the South Dakota Regional Office. And they are participants in this Habitat Pays expertise group of folks. They're among them. There's others. In the middle, we have Jeff Zimprick. I got to know Jeff. He's the state conservationist for the United States Department of Agricultural Natural Resources Conservation Service. I'm sure many of you worked with the NRCS before, and you might know Jeff. I got to know Jeff when we had the pheasant habitat summit several years ago in December, in the year following the extreme drought in 2013. Our pheasants population just fell off a cliff because of weather primarily, but also because of decline in habitat. And so Jeff was very good about showing the decline in CRP acres and how over long periods of time you can see pheasants decline about the same rate as habitat declines. And over long periods of time you can see pheasants increase as habitat increases. Year to year, weather will create a lot of volatility year to year. So if you have a very poor hatch weather, you're going to see pheasants drop off. But then they'll recover again if the habitat is there and the weather gets better again. Anyway, so I got to know Jeff, and he knows a lot about habitat, and I'm looking forward to hearing from him. And then Jerry Schmitz is a farmer in the Vermilion area, and Jerry's going to talk a little bit about what he's doing personally. He's one of you. If you're a producer, he's one of you, and he's interested in habitat and in pollinators, and so we're going to hear a little bit from him. But let's begin with Matt Morlock, again, the acting director of Pheasants Forever South Dakota Regional Office. Matt, let's give him a welcome round of applause.
Okay, can you guys hear me? Perfect. I'll slide her up. I'm not used to speaking with mics, so I'm a little rusty on that. Normally, I'm loud enough that everybody can hear me. So thank you, Governor, for that introduction. I feel like it's a little bit backwards. Normally, I'll introduce you and not be introduced by you. So but I appreciate the welcome here. This is a fun opportunity for me to speak in front of an audience that I normally don't speak to a lot. A lot of times, we get the question of, why is Pheasants Forever so involved with pollinators? And as you spoke about, it's very important to the agricultural community. One out of every three bites of food that we eat comes from pollinators or directly, from their efforts. But we're a little bit more selfish than that. We love, nothing's more exciting to me than that third weekend in October. I get to, with my job, I'm lucky enough, I get to go out and go to banquets around the state, people, and every town has that story. There's a gentleman in Westington Springs that comes every year. He's been doing it for 20 years from Atlanta, Georgia. Down in Mitchell, a group of guys from Tennessee, they've been coming for 35 years. Every community has that story. So pheasant hunting, that tradition, it's vital to our state, and it's something that, in the hunting world, it's a bucket list opportunity. Most people look forward to, at some time in their life, coming to our state and experiencing the pheasant hunting opportunities we have, because it's the best in the world. And without pollinators and insects, that wouldn't be possible. So selfishly, that's why we get involved with pollinators. That's why I get excited about it, is I love that tradition, and it wouldn't be possible without that. And I'm going to apologize. I'm going to use the term, I'm going to slip up and talk about pollinator habitat, about That's how we refer to it at Pheasants Forever. With pheasants, they have an interesting life. They have a life cycle that's less than a year long. So they're a very high turnover bird. So you got to really focus in on their needs. That's very important to them. And with pheasants, the most important stage of their life is that first 9 weeks of their life, where they're trying to put on weight. And we have a big issue is what we call thermal regulation. They have to be able to get to a certain size so that they can regulate body temperatures. And to do that, they need a diet that's really high in insects. And in fact, it's 90% or greater of their diet needs to be insects in order to get there. If that percentage drops by even a 1 or 2%, it adds...
insects, not sex.
Yeah, insects. Okay. Yes, yeah. Good clarification.
Insects.
Very good clarification. One of them is needed, but not as important. That's hard to segue off of that. But if that percentage, that 90% drops by even 1 or 2%, that adds a day or two to their life cycle that they can't get to that thermal regulation point. And they're still, those chicks are still dependent on that hen. They have to brood underneath her at night or during the daytime. That's a really bad time is if it's too hot. They can't cool themselves down and we lose those chicks. So having enough insects out there for them to have that good diet so that they can get to that point in their life, that's 90% of the battle in raising a pheasant population. Last year was the prime example of that. With the drought that went on and the fact that we had 95 degree weather right at peak hatch in our state, we lost our chicks really quickly because there wasn't dew for those insects and the flowering plants weren't growing. They were stunted because of the drought. So our chicks couldn't get that diet and we lost a very large portion of our population within the first week of their lives. And that, you know, was the key to why our population went down so much last year. They were able to find enough places to nest last year, but they didn't have enough of that food source for them to get to that next life cycle. So that's why, you know, we're so adamant about pollinators and pollinator habitat is just because it's so tied in with their life cycle. And that goes for all bird species. And this picture here up on the PowerPoint, you know, that's a picture of a guy with some prairie grouse, both sharp tails and prairie chickens. It's the same thing for them. And they can correlate to all bird species, that they need insects in order to get through their life cycle and get to that adult stage where we can enjoy them. So that's why Pheasants Forever has been so into the pollinator world and why we believe in it so much and talk about it so much. I'm going to demonstrate that a little bit here. I got a little bit of a video. I'm hoping it's going to play. I don't always have good luck with technology. But this video will show you and kind of give you more of a visual read on this thing. This was filmed down, a coworker of mine down in Nebraska filmed it. Well, that ain't gonna do it. Yep, if you can just point on and hit play. Technology works for me about half the time, so this might be that half that it doesn't work. Otherwise, I can just, you know, what this video is gonna would show is it's a bunch of pheasant chicks that they were able to film and capture. It's about a minute-long video of them going in and just showing them going after insects and how they attack them and approach them. The front part is them going after a bunch of ants. Then a little later on, it's a little bit about them going after ladybugs. And the moral of that is they really they're not picking one species of bugs. So we need to manage for all of them because they're using all of them. And they don't really care, and they're just ferocious at them. It's kind of fun in these pollinator talks I get to be the guy that talks about the apex predator. Normally I go to meetings, everything's trying to eat my species that I'm interested in. This time they're the ones that are doing all the eating, so it's kind of fun for that. But I just can't stress that enough, that these pollinators are intricately tied into our hunting tradition. I mean, without them, without their habitat, we wouldn't have that tradition. And typically, in my prior life, I was a farm bill biologist, one of the habitat advisors that the governor was talking about. And I'd go out and meet with landowners and talk specifically about pheasant habitat. And we always, when we talked to them about their goals, they'd always talk about, well, when I'm out in the fall hunting, you know, they're in our food plots and they're in our shelter belts, so I need more of those. That's what I need for more pheasants in my population, in my land. And it was hard to correlate and talk with them a little bit about that. You know, you're out there during that time, and those birds have shifted over to that habitat type. But the rest of the year, they're using the flowering plants, the native pastures, and the grasslands. Where you're not seeing, because they always say, well, I'm not seeing any pheasants in that part of the area, so they're not using it at all. I said, so it was hard to get them to understand that that habitat that wasn't useful for them in the fall was actually what was most important for them to have their opportunity in the fall. So you have to make that transition from the food plot discussion, which is that picture on the left there, to the picture on the right, which is a good picture, an example of pollinator habitat, which they didn't see that bird out there. And I always challenged my landowners I was working with to get out there in the springtime and in the summertime instead of just showing up in the fall and hunting. I mean, you need to look at that habitat throughout the year to get a better understanding of it. So I can't stress that enough. And most producers, after a while, would come to understand this. And it was really a rewarding process. We need the winter cover for those devastating blizzards and stuff like that. But if we're not producing the birds on the front end in the springtime and getting them to an adult stage, that doesn't mean anything. So we need to really focus in on that early habitat. So that's a little bit about why Pheasants Forever, you know, is so involved with it. Now I'm going to jump into a little bit about the work we've been doing around the state over the last few years. And I'm going to caveat that with, you know, we work a lot with the federal and state programs that are existing. And I promised Jeff I wouldn't take over his PowerPoint and his talking point. So I'm going to leave that aside and just talk about the work that we're doing in partnership with a bunch of other agencies and organizations. And keep in mind that that's running sympatrically with these federal and state programs that are out there and that Jeff will talk about a little bit later. Our initial starting point was prior to 2013, which this slide talks about, was we have our farm bill biologists, which are habitat advisors that the governor was talking about. And we have 13 of those surrounded around the state that go out and meet with landowners and develop habitat plans and conservation plans and things like that. And they always worked with the available programs and things like that. But starting in about 2013, we saw a need to provide a little bit extra on the side programs that sometimes the federal programs didn't fit for that landowner. It wasn't the right fit, or they didn't qualify for those programs, but they still wanted to do the work. So we started developing our own programs. And one of them, we took a two-prong approach, was the first thing we did is a lot of work with the youth. We started working in the school districts with FFA and stuff like that. We took our chapter volunteers that are out around the state, and they'd have pollinator days at the schools. And to date, we've worked with 32 different school districts around our state. I couldn't get a solid number on the number of students, but it's in the thousands of students that we've sat down and worked with around the state. And what we do at these events is we take them out to the field and get their hands dirty. They plant seeds. They just broadcast seed on a plot that's been worked up by the landowner. We talk about, you know, the insects and the importance of them. And then we send them home with a big ball of clay that has a bunch of seed on it that they can grow for themselves. And personally, I can speak to the effectiveness of this because my fourth grader this year had a pollinator event at a school in Brookings. And he came home from that and he started telling me about all this stuff. And I'm like, yeah, I understand. And then he goes, I want to get into the bee production business. So now I'm a beehive owner. We got a couple beehives going now, and it's all because of that youth pollinator event that they had at their school district, and that kid got jacked up. And so I never thought I'd own a beehive, but now I have two of them sitting in my backyard getting ready to go. So next year we're going to start trying to produce a little bit of honey. But it was kind of fun to see that on a personal level, see that kid get excited about it, come in with dirt under his fingernails, and be excited about insects and honeybees and all that stuff. So we continue that effort. That's been going on since 2013. Then in 2015, we launched what we called the Next Gen program. We provided landowners with free seed and then a small stipend to establish that seed. And what it was two different seed mixes, so the acres that the landowner was enrolling in the program were split in half. Half of it was designed specifically for honeybees, and the other half of it was designed for the native pollinators, especially monarchs. And that program worked very well. We put in about 550 acres randomly around the state. And it worked, like I said, really well. A lot of producers were interested in that program. But around 2016, 17, we started to have a little bit of a philosophical switch where we called it affectionately random acts of conservation. We were just doing a pollinator plot here, there, and everywhere. And we decided we needed to get more focused in and hit different levels of things on the landscape and look at it more holistically. So we took that program and we passed it on to the partners that were also involved with that program. So it's still active. It's just not a Pheasants Forever program anymore. But so we decided, you know, we're going to focus in a little bit more on issues that would solve soil health and multiple problems on the landscape, because that way it compounded those dollars. Federal dollars and private dollars are hard to come by out there in our world. So we need to make sure we're making multiple impacts with the little bit of funds that we had. So from that, we started looking at, what are some problem soils on the landscape that producers are losing returns on constantly, and they were kind of that low-hanging fruit. It was a drain on that farm economy. It was a drain on the local area. And one of the things that just rose to the top was saline and sodic soils for us. Everybody's probably seen them on the landscape. There's white spots where nothing is growing. Producers, though, through convenience, things like that, they would keep farming through them, or just they didn't know what to do with them, so they kept running their crop or their planters through them. But they were really losing, and the analysis showed $1 to $200 an acre on these things. So through your work, Governor, with the Pheasant Summit and the Conservation Habitat Foundation, and we were able to launch in 2015 a pilot program in Spink County, Brown County, and Fault County, where we worked with about 15 producers on 1,000 acres to enroll into the saline and sodic pilot program. And it went very well. We signed those landowners up pretty much the next day and had good luck. What we do with this program is we give them free seed and then another stipend, $150 an acre stipend. And the seed mix that we plant out there has been developed to be A, strong on forage quality, and B, strong on wildlife habitat. With these soils, it's a little challenging, so they're not as diverse as we would like to have sometimes, but it's strong with the salt-tolerant alfalfa, wheat grasses, and things like that. And like I said, that program in the pilot phase was very successful. This year at Pheasant Fest, we got a challenge thrown at us, and it was pretty fun to see. South Dakota corn growers came on and said, we have some money, we'll get put at it, we love this program. You need to go out and raise more money to do this, and we want to make this a bigger thing. So from there, we've taken this program now. This year, we're launching it in 30 counties across the state, that areas that are highly impacted with saline soils. There's about 2 million acres across the landscape, so it is a big issue. So this is the start of it. So we have South Dakota Corn Growers and Pheasants Forever now partnered up on this program. Just a couple weeks ago, we received a grant to double our money from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation with some money from NRCS to double that effort. So we're going to be able to work with about, I'm going to guess, 30 producers around the state and a couple thousand acres as another way to launch us a little bit more. You're going to see a little bit more of an ad campaign and education built into this program. So you're going to see a lot more about this out there, saline and sodic soils. And we also brought in, I don't have their logo up here, but we brought in SDSU as being very involved with this. Like I said, with these soils, they're kind of a challenge to get species growing on them. They became pretty sterile. So SDSU is coming in and helping us on the research end of it. We're going to be testing about 40 or 50 different species of native flowering plants to see what levels they can grow in and what ones will grow so that we can kind of expand that list even more and learn from it. So it's been really fun to watch because it's really bringing in that ag and wildlife community together and really tackling this issue. And so that's where we kind of focus. And like I said, it's a holistic approach. It's a soil health approach. It's doing a lot for pollinators, but it's also working for those producers, and healing those soils and making them work again so that they're not sterile and that kind of stuff. So that's kind of our focus on the cropland is that saline soils effort. The other thing I want to talk about, and once again, technology's failing me here. My picture didn't show up. You can picture a herd of Hereford, Charolais, a couple Holsteins walking across a nice diverse prairie. So they're all out there. That's what's on this picture. I don't want to discriminate against any cattle breeds, so we had them all in this picture. Just trust me on that. But that's the native prairie out there is often overlooked as for the pollinator benefits. I typically would go out and work with producers, and we'd focus on their cropland acres and talk about pollinator habitat and diverse plantings there. In the meantime, I'd be looking over my shoulder at the native prairie on the other side of the pasture land and start talking about, what are you doing with that? Well, just grazing it. We put our cattle out there and graze it year-round. I was working over in the eastern part of the state where there's less rotation going on and things like that. So we'd always migrate over to there, and we'd start walking around to that native prairie and start pointing out plant species and things like that. And, doing the math in my head quickly, and next thing I'd know, I'd tell those producers that, you got about a $400 seed mix sitting out here that you didn't have to put a dime into. Let's work on that management on that native prairie lands, too, and we can make that work for you also. things like rotational grazing systems, more adaptive pesticide management, not just spraying for the sake of spraying and targeting your spraying efforts. You can really work with those native prairies to release the pollinator flowering plants. That's a really low-cost way of doing things. So on that end, we this spring launched a program in partnership with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and once again NIF, WIF, and NRCS to do West River, South Dakota. We're doing grazing infrastructure installments. We have about $500,000 where we're going to provide free material to landowners for both water development and fencing materials. We're focusing in a little bit. Part of it has to be on expiring CRP land, but it can also be on associated native range land. And what we're doing there is we're really wanting to also capture the loss of CRP acres and keep them in grass, but also making those native range lands around there better for pollinators, wildlife, and grazing. So that program just launched this year. It's looking very like it's going to be a very popular program also. So the point of that whole thing is don't forget about that native prairie sitting out there. Let's look at that. That's extremely important, and it's a cheap way to do pollinator benefits. We just need to change a little bit about management on it. And a lot of times, when we start doing better rotational grazing stuff, you see better beef production also. So it really works out for everybody. So with that, I'm going to get kind of quiet here as fast as I can, but I just want to put this map up here. It's not showing up very well, but this is a list of our 13 biologists that we have spread around our state. Feel free to reach out to them. Habitat Pays website has their contact information on them. And they would gladly go out and meet with you on a Saturday or Sunday or whenever it works and talk with them. And if they, they're, like the governor said, they're versed in the federal programs, the state programs, our programs. So they're really there to help you guys and meet your end goals. It might not be pheasants and it might not be wildlife. It might be better production on your pasture land or problem soils. They're trained in all those programs so they can come out and help you and make sure that this really fits into your needs and find that right fit for you. So if you want to go to Habitat Pays, you can find all their contact information. Otherwise, on the last slide here is my contact information. You can always reach out to the South Dakota Regional Office of Pheasants Forever and we can get you in the right place. So that's all I got. I'll turn it over to Jim.
Matt, let's give Matt a round of applause. Thank you so much. Our next panelist, as I said earlier, is Jeff Zinfrich. He's the state conservationist for the USDA NRCS. Jeff, we're looking forward to hearing from you.
I'm looking forward to it as well. Hopefully that's coming through okay. I think so. Hearing me okay? Great. Matt, you did a great job of just sitting there. I can't do that. So I'm going to wander around here. I'll stop every once in a while, especially when I think it's about 20 minutes, Governor, and you can boot me in the rear end if I get going too long.
Okay.
But no, I'm really excited to be with you today. And I'm going to do something that I haven't done in the 6 years I've been state conservationist in NRCS. And that is there's going to be a little bit of time I'm going to take off my NRCS hat and I'm going to actually put on the producer hat and tell you a couple stories about what my father and I have done on the farm that I grew up on that sounds a lot like the governor's farm that he grew up on, and just share a few of the stories, but show you how we've used one of Matt's programs and we also used one of the USDA programs to put some habitat out there that we're really proud of and watching, okay? So we'll just kind of get there. First of all, I'm here really today representing all of USDA. Definitely the part that's called the farm production and conservation side. So when Secretary Perdue became secretary, one of the things he did is he did some realignments and he took the Farm Service Agency and NRCS and RMA and he put us in a new family. We used to be part of the family with the Forest Service, but he put us with this group and I think it's gonna do some really good things. So one of the things it's gonna do today is allow me to work on a few of the Farm Service Agency programs and share a little bit about those with you as well. Those are programs that they administer, but we provide technical support to, but I'm gonna be excited to share a few ideas and then how we've put it to use. First of all, back to NRCS, and the governor talked about this and Matt talked about this as well, but I think one of the most important things we have to offer is actually our technical assistance, our planning advice, okay? I think it's confusing for producers. There is a lot of information out there. There's all the program stuff that can get confusing. But the other part is just what's the best thing to do? What's the right seeding mix? What's the right time to seed? How much of this seed should I put on? What diversity will work good together? If I've got some stand of grasses that I want to actually slow down or kill before I plant my pollinators, how do I best do that? And so I think this is one of the most things that we have to offer. We're kind of, in a way, one of those habitat advisors. We have our field offices scattered all across South Dakota, and there's people there that have some knowledge to assist you. And if they don't have the knowledge, they know where to go get it, and so that there's time available to work with you and help you with your needs. And it's individual. And one of those things that would be part of that is like basic soils information. So NRCS has South Dakota mapped in soils, and we can share that information with you. In addition, we've got a lot of those technical resources, and we brought some of those today, and they're outside on the panel or outside the door, and I'll mention that in just a little bit again, just to remind you. But grab some of those things if they're of interest to you, just for more information on monarchs and honeybees and pollinators in general and a few of those topics. But when we spend time working with those producers, one of the things we really try to do is bring all the natural resources together, okay? And what I want you to see from this slide is they all come together in the middle where there is a producer that's the focal point. If it cannot work for the private landowner, it's not going to be successful. And it all has to come together that way. But the other cool part that I want to show you about this slide is that we are finding more and more that we can bring various resource issues together and solve them and provide benefits many ways. Some of you may have come here today and said, okay, if we're going to do something to help pollinators, I'm going to have to give up land. I'm not going to be able to utilize land. My answer to you is, no, that's not true. I think there's lots of benefits. And a couple of the stories I'll talk briefly about that happened on our farm was, we did things that we wanted to do to improve the land, improve our bottom line, protect land for water quality, all those things, and provide other habitat, including habitat for pollinators. And it could all come together in the center. So what's ahead now, what I want to do with you is share just a few programs, a little bit of information. I'm not going to go into it real deep. And then I'm going to share just a few examples of how it's being put to use. First of all, now I'm going to speak for just a little bit for the Farm Service Agency and the Conservation Security Program. I noticed this slide was shared earlier today as well, just showing some work along our riparian areas in South Dakota. So in CRP and statistics, and these are a little dated, and CRP now is actually about 33 years old. It started in the 2000, in the Farm Bill that happened in 1985, was when it was first authorized. And I actually, Lynn, got to work on that. So that tells you a little bit how old I am, I guess. But I was in Montana at the time. I was a soil conservationist and district conservationist and enrolling many acres into that program. Right now in South Dakota, and this is a little hard to read, we have about 1.1 million acres. It might be getting closer to a million acres. But the point that I'd make is you'll see that there's about 250,000 in general sign up, but there's almost 700,000 acres in more of a continuous sign up. And it's those continuous sign ups where things got much more specific. Okay, that's where there was actually things that were happening that we're addressing specifically: declining habitats, riparian areas, trees, wetlands, pollinators, and we'll talk just about a few of those. The next slide talks about one of those kind of specialized issues, and that's CP25, and that was a rare and declining habitat, primarily prairie habitat. And so a diverse mix of plants were planted, and those maps give you a view of some of the counties in eastern South Dakota that used that fairly significantly and put quite a bit of habitat on the land. In addition, they developed a CP42, which was a pollinator habitat program, to do specific work that way. And this is a practice that we actually put to use on our farm, and I would tell you just a little bit about that story. And that story starts out just giving you a really quick view of our landscape. So the farm that I grew up on, Governor, was near Brandon, about 3 miles south of Brandon, about 4 miles east of Sioux Falls. It's on Beaver Creek, runs through our land, comes from Beaver Creek, Minnesota, and wanders down, dumps into the Split Rock River, just a half a mile from where I grew up, and that dumps into the Big Sioux River about another half mile away. Lots of water coming together there, and lots of flooding. So this story started actually about 22 years ago when Beaver Creek flooded very bad, cut the heck out of our cornfield, deposited sand dunes out in our field that were nearly as tall as I was, and really hurt a piece of land. And we enrolled that in CRP at that time, 20 years ago, into a scour program, a program that was really meant for land that had been flooded. It was seeded down to native grasses, big blue stem, Indian, and switchgrass, and we planted some shrubs. But it had three primary grass species. Dad left that in CRP for 20 years, and we managed it. We used fire and a few other things to manage that land, and it did its job, but it did not make the soil as healthy as it could. So when it recently came out, we decided, hey, let's do something different. Let's enroll it into the CRP pollinator program, and let's add diversity to the land. So we're thinking about pollinators, but we're really thinking about diversity and improving our soils the best we could. So we did a lot of work. We had 6 foot high, big blue, Indian, and switch. First thing we did is we sprayed it in the fall with Roundup to try to knock that back. We had to like take some of that competition away. After that was done, then we went in the spring and we burned it to remove a lot of vegetation. And then we let it green up again, different species, and we sprayed it one more time. And we followed that immediately with a seeding. I was out there several weeks later looking, and I could see where the drill head went. I was seeing small grasses popping up and a few of the forbs, a few of the flowers that were coming along, and I was feeling really good about things. I had been working. I work out of Huron now, so I'm driving across the state. I don't get back to the farm all that time. I come back about a month later, and this is what it looks like. That's milkweed. Milkweed was released on that site. It had always been there before, but when we took away the competition from the native grasses, milkweed just exploded. It was really neat to see. The other things were coming underneath of it. I wasn't concerned about it, and I knew we were developing some excellent habitat. By fall, a lot of the other species were coming. In this picture in the background, that's big blue stem standing there high. You got a milkweed plant, you got some other plants coming along, and you can see, if you could look real close, you can see some little blue stem and some of the other plants that are side oats grandma that are coming along. So we're getting more diverse, and we know diversity is going to be better for that soil. Started seeing monarchs show up. I was out on this land last weekend, and as I stood around and making sure there weren't no thistles that were getting ahead of us, and I'm doing those cuttings by hand, I'm seeing monarchs just flying all over, and I'm seeing a lot of other diversity. So I think it's really working and being put to good use. So that's an example of how CRP would be one program that NRCS and other habitat advisors could direct you to. Slide's got a little bit of coverage there, but we'll be okay with that. Now I want to shift to a few of the Farm Bill conservation programs that NRCS takes care of. I'm going to talk about the Environmental Quality Incentives Program quickly, Conservation Stewardship quickly, share an example there, and then bounce down to our easement program real quick, and then wrap up. First of all, EQIP stands for the Environmental Quality Incentives Program. I just shared that. And really, it's our program that offers the most flexibility. First step, start with a great conservation plan. Know what you want to do. Work with the habitat advisors and NRCS to get that done. Once that's done, we can enroll you in a contract. This program is funded at about $15 million, I would say, over the long-term average in South Dakota. It is oversubscribed, and what I mean by that, if there's more desire for this program than we have money available, but we go through a competitive process and get the dollars on the land that will provide us the most benefit. Through EQIP, we can do lots of different things. We actually had targeted honeybee work, and we put about 100 and some contracts out on the land for about 24,000 acres, and in those honeybee projects, we did some seedings, we did grazing management, we did many of the things that Matt talked about. On the traditional EQIP side, again, we can do seedings and grazing management and pesticide management and cover crops and a whole list of things as well. And all of those things make a difference. We can shift to the Conservation Stewardship Program, another program very popular in South Dakota. 7 million acres in the program now, that's the largest in the United States by quite a ways. And stewardship is a program that really helps take producers' management to the next step. Okay, so with EQIP, you can put in fences and a lot of the infrastructure. CSP can help you more about how to manage that grassland and manage it better, and the same on the cropland side. A couple of the cool things in stewardship is we can do some seedings, and we've done some, but through the life of CSP in South Dakota, we've planted over 234,000 acres of cover crops. Okay, Zimprich, why are you talking about cover crops, right? Because what's that going to have to do with pollinators? Right in this picture, although it doesn't show up really well, are some sunflowers and a lot of other diversity in that mix. Almost every cover crop mix planted is going to be full of a lot of broadleafs, forbs, flowering plants that are going to be good for pollinators. So the cow can be happy, the soil can be happy, the pollinators can be happy, the ground nesting birds can be happy, the producer can be happy. Win, 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 right? So not only can we start thinking about that we can have pollinator habitat on grasslands and on prairie, we can actually have pollinator habitat on cropland as well. A story of that, this is Chris Hintzman. He's a producer from down in the Lake Andes area, Charles Mix County. He had a lot of things that he wanted to work on in his operation. It wasn't just pollinator habitat, it wasn't just pheasants. He wanted that, but he also wanted to improve his soil. You can see on the left, he's checking on compaction. He's using a probe that helps him measure compaction. He's digging some soil up, looking at the color and the quality and the texture and all of those things. And then he's standing amongst some of those things. He's using some grazing. He's got a pheasant hunting operation. He's renting out some land, but he's doing a lot of this to improve the soil. So again, win, 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 win. I would shift real quick now to the ACEP program, which is an easement program that we administer. ACEP stands for the Agricultural Conservation Easement Program. I always try to slow down and make sure I don't give you just acronyms. But ACEP is kind of the version of our easement programs from the last Farm Bill. Prior to that, it would have been the Wetland Reserve Program and a few others, and it shifted to this now, but we're still doing a lot. This year marks 25 years for those programs across the country. And in South Dakota, we have over 3,000 easements, and about those easements total about 151,000 acres. Many of them have good diverse seedings on them, but not all. So one of the things that we started doing this year is working with producers and saying, you have an easement, what are your objectives? Would your objectives include diversifying your mixture? If it does, maybe we could work with you. So this year, in the next 3 years, it started last year, it's happening now, it's gonna happen in 19, we're gonna seed about 3,800 acres down to diverse pollinator mixes. That's gonna happen across 49 easements in 17 counties, and it's just the start. Lots of interest growing. That's gonna improve the soil, that's gonna improve water quality, that can improve that land for grazing and other things because there's some of those rights that they are allowed to do on that land because those easements need to be managed to stay healthy. Again, win, 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 win. These pictures come from one of our easements in Brookings County, where a producer was interested in doing that. And you see the diversity that's been added to that landscape. So I want to kind of close with one of the programs that Matt talked about. I've got just a few slides left. I wanted to share a story of where we had some land different than what the governor talked about in the fact that this land was on a hillside. But this hillside was really sandy and rocky. And when my dad bought this farm, this land was being farmed, but it was not producing a crop. It was eroding at some times, but even more importantly, it was eroding dad's pocketbook. He made the decision on this roughly 4 acres to just take it out of production 20 years ago. Might have been longer than that. We seeded it down to kind of a brome alfalfa mix. We hayed it, we grazed it. The brome kind of took over, right? And we pretty much had that brome stand. Not very diverse. I would go out there and I'd look at the land and I'd say, man, it's really not getting better. And I thought one of the main reasons was it lacked diversity. It was just brome. So we went through a process where we killed that brome. We worked with Matt on that program he discussed to plant a mixture of both a honeybee mix and a monarch mix. And we got that seeded out there. You can see there's a few green spots. That's where Dad missed with the sprayer. I had to give him a little hard time with that. A little bit more brome coming back in those spots. But immediately we've seen good things happen. This is the first fall, and if you look at this picture, it's hard to see, but right here you can see a little building and this row of trees. So right here, you can't see it on that TV very well. So over here, it's that building and that row of trees. And I'll just show you a series of successive pictures. This was first fall. We were starting to see pollinators out there already year one. This was spring, same building, same trees, year two. Not so much ground cover though, and that worried me. This was the fall of that second year, a lot more happening, and the flowers and the pollinators just exploded. And what I see now out there is that diversity has continued to mature. We're in that agreement with Matt and Pheasants Forever for two more years, and at the end of that, we can do with what we see fit on the land. But what Dad and I are talking about is we're gonna put a fence around this, we're gonna include it into a small grazing system, we're gonna use it intensively and then stay out, and I think that can help us even take soil health even further. So again, our goal wasn't necessarily just pollinators. It was a lot of things, and it came together, and we could make it happen. So I mentioned earlier some materials right outside the door that are available for you to pick up, and we at NRCS are definitely willing to help you. Now, one of the challenges that I think we have to talk about is how do we make this issue be important? So Matt, I'm gonna try technology and see if we can make it work, or we're gonna play just a short video that is an effort that a lot of South Dakota groups have been working on to maybe tell that story. And I hope when you see this, you go, hey, I've seen that on TV. No? You got it? Perfect. Thank you.
A lot of birds and pollinators are totally dependent upon the habitat and the plants of the native prairies. And if one in three bites of food that we eat is dependent upon pollinators, it's important to all of us. So what are we going to do about it? I think we need to just get real serious real fast. The plants are healthy, the animals are healthy, the water's clean, it's beautiful. I don't think we'd be here without it.
Short and sweet. And there's been about three other commercials that have come out on really about soil, water, prairies, just habitat, and that whole work is going to continue. I think that's an area where we could challenge all of ourselves. Many of you represent groups. How do we come together and keep telling that story more? So to end, kind of my final quote is, you know, take care of the land and it'll take care of you. I think that looking out for pollinators, looking out for the health of our soils, looking out for our water quality is what brings us all together. That's what makes agriculture strong. Agriculture is our number one industry. It all is really all based on those natural resources, and then this natural resource that lays out right here in front of me, all of you people. So I know if we work together, we can make a lot of good things happen. So I'll end with, Governor, your knowledge that you shared this morning was amazing. So when it's time to go back to the farm, we have several good programs where you could come to work for us, and I think Matt could make you a habitat advisor. I think a lot of good things that could happen.
I am going to need a new job here at the end of the year. Getting fired here.
You bet. Well, thank you so
much.
Let's
give him a round of applause. Thank you. Jeff, good job. Now, we've heard from a couple of viewpoints of how the professionals who've been doing this for years can help producers. Now let's hear from a producer who is at the other side of that table and how he utilized habitat on his own land. Jerry Schmitz. Jerry, thank you for being with us. Let's give him a round of welcome.
Good morning. My name is Jerry Schmitz. I farm at Vermilion. My background is I grew up on a farm at Elk Point with seven brothers and sisters. We had hogs, cattle, chickens, turkeys, ducks, geese, guineas, and peacocks. And we didn't need ADT as a home security system because when anything came on the farm, we knew about it. As a matter of fact, today we don't see it as much. We get calls on the phone from salespeople. But back then, it wasn't uncommon to have salespeople driving on the place often and just kind of pestering. So if you can imagine, for those of you who do know about roosters who are territorial, imagine a salesperson with a rooster on his back running toward his car. That was home. One of the things that we learned early, the eight of us on the farm, was that all of those animals needed attention, and that meant someone had to take responsibility. and that meant each of us had a chore. And no one got to have breakfast, or at the end of the day got to have supper, until our responsibility to the animals was fulfilled. We were told that we were the caretakers, that their well-being depended upon us, and that throughout the rest of our lives, there would be people and animals and land that needed to be taken care of, and we were responsible. The term sustainability really didn't exist back then, but I think that's what I would equate it with now. Sustainability means a little bit different things to different people, but to me, it still means responsibility. You see the hives here. That took place over a period of 3 to 5 years, and I'm going to say that it was a selfish decision, mostly, although I had been thinking about it for a number of years. And the reason I say selfish, about 7 years ago, my wife was diagnosed with rheumatoid and osteoarthritis. And the doctors told her that one of the better things that she could do was have honey that was produced nearby. And so we started looking into starting our own apiary. And like I say, 3 to 5 years, I was learning, finding out what affected the bees. And at that time, the bee populations were going down. And so I learned about the weather patterns. I learned about the pesticides. I learned about where they need to get water, what the diseases were. And I was within a week of purchasing when I was overhearing a conversation in town between two people, and one of them said, I'd really like to find a farmer that wouldn't mind having beehives on their property. And immediately, there was a partnership developed. And so we began doing the honeybees. This is actually another reason we decided to do that. And these pictures are off of our farm. On the left, the cherries, and they are the tart cherries. The middle picture is of our apricots, and then the one on the right is apples. We have a small orchard just for ourselves. We don't sell any produce, but I like to make jams and jellies and sauces and give them out as Christmas gifts, and we enjoy them ourselves. We try to teach our kids as well that you can enjoy life with some of the simple things. Take care of people, take care of yourselves, and share with others. And this is one of the ways to do that. And I want to thank both Matt and Jeff, because they have taken us, they're really taking us back to the way I grew up, and that is you go to your neighbors and you find out the things that you have in common and how you can better yourselves. And Matt, with your program on Saline, that was something that would take place in past years. You would go to your neighbor and say, what can we do to work together, because we both have a problem that we'd like to solve. And it's fantastic that you're doing that with producers. And Jeff, I know you're out there every day, and you help us to do things that are better, not only for ourselves, but for the world population. And that's pretty important. Governor, thank you for everything that you do. This is kind of the beginning, and the reason I chose this slide is because I know Jeff comes out once in a while, and I didn't want him to see the weeds that actually take place, so this is pretty carefully positioned. and somebody mentioned Canada thistle, and I have to tell you, this year, for the first time, I am seeing more thistle in places that I have never seen them. I don't know how long that seed stays in the ground. Just to step back a little bit, we have been so wet since last fall. This spring, beginning in April, we were getting 1 to 3 inches each week. And up to 3 weeks ago, in 12 days, we got 12 inches. And so it's been a battle. We were hoping to get some pollinator in and haven't been able to. We do have some beautiful flowers, and those are Canada thistle. We haven't been able to treat those. And they have gone to seed now. But anyway, this is an area on the outskirts of where we will be putting the pollinator. And much like Jeff's picture where he had corn stalks, we have some of that as well. And that will be going into pollinator habitat. This is what we're hoping that it will look like in another year. And Bees themselves are tremendous pollinators, but they bring in other insects, as was mentioned earlier. And really, it goes beyond that. The other insects bring in some smaller birds. The smaller birds are interesting to some of the larger birds, and then you start getting mammals in, and it just ends up being the circle of life, and I can hear Jeff humming Hakuna Matata. Again, some of the things that we want to have our land look like in the near future. And these are things that are fairly simple to do. There's an expense there, but NRCS assists with that. Pheasants Forever is wonderful in assisting with those sorts of things. And so we're all kind of moving in a direction where we're partners. And I don't know if anybody has noticed it, but it seems like society today is getting more polarized. I know it's not that way in Washington, but out here in the country, and we look for that one thing where we disagree, and then when you disagree with me, you are Darth Vader, and I don't want anything to do with you anymore. And these are the types of things that'll bring us back to the land. And that's pretty much all I have, Governor. Thank you.
Very good. Let's give a round of applause to Jerry. Thank you so much. All right, now we've got a little bit of time for questions, and I'm going to start out with a few questions. Well, first thing I want to ask of you, Matt, you talked out in your presentation about saline soils and some of the efforts that are being used to combat those soils. And say again, you said saline, and then you had another word.
Sodic.
Okay, like soda, yeah. Sodic. Saline and sodic oils, or soils. And I read an article here just recently, and it turned the light bulb on for me, and I'm sure it's probably the only person in this whole room maybe that didn't know this, but in case there is, let me offer what I understood is being done by planting some of these deep-rooted grasses on the saline soils. Some of the cause of a saline soil is because we have taken away the native plant, replaced it with a cropping system, or maybe not, but in any case, then there has been a sustained, very wet period. And the flooding that occurs with the sustained wet period brings salts up to the surface of the soil. And then you continue to crop, but there's nothing to get the salts back down deeper into the soil column. And if you, instead of planting some of these shallow-rooted annual crops that we've been planting and failing to grow on these areas, if you can get established a deeper-rooted grass or other plant, then when you do have a rain event, it'll follow those roots down deeper in the soil column and draw those salts down deeper into the earth. So at some point in time in the future, you've got a topsoil that's much less saline than it was to begin with. Is that the process?
Yeah, you nailed it right there. It's a soil health issue and just a water issue. Like you said, when you're annually cropping it and you have shallow-rooted plants, a hard clay pan kind of forms about a foot down below the surface, and that water then comes up, but it cannot go back down. And in that soil is a lot of, I'm going to get these chemicals wrong, but calcium carbonate and stuff like that, that comes up, it's water soluble, comes up to the top with that water. The water evaporates in the air because it can't go back down because of that clay pan, and then it just sits there. So with the perennial plants and deep-rooted plants like that, it kind of breaks that clay pan apart again, and lets that water start flowing back down in the column, and it disperses all those minerals back into the soils where they're supposed to be at. So it just makes that water cycle work again. And luckily for us, that's the solution for it because we, like Jeff likes to say, win, win, win. And we fix that soil issue. We make that farm more profitable, but then we also get pheasant habitat and pollinator habitat off that also. So it works out very well. But it's just simple things like that you can change and address water issues and stuff like that and get those side benefits off it.
Very good. Thank you. Jeff and Jerry, a question for the two of you in turn. Jeff, you were talking about establishing some pollinator on your property. And Jerry, I know you've done a little and are looking to do more, but what challenges have you faced in either establishing them when you're first trying to seed. Water, I guess, is maybe one already identified. But not only in establishing them at the outset, but also maintaining them. And I'll give you some personal experience. When I came into office, those of you from the Pier area, or maybe you've read in the paper elsewhere, the Pier area has a gulch that's north of the Capitol that had been converted to a very large bluegrass area. And there was a sprinkler system installed, and a lot of bluegrass was planted, and the state was paying quite a bit of money to mow and fertilize and water. Just to give you a sense, $50,000 a year for the water bill alone. And so I said to myself, as a taxpayer, how do I feel about that? Not very good, because it was mostly an area that was seen as sort of a park for the Pier area. Well, that's great, but we've got the whole state paying for this huge water bill, and that's just the water. That's not the cost of mowing it, overseeding it, fertilizing it, herbicide to keep it looking like a lawn or like a golf course, really. And this was, I don't know, 10 acres, quite a bit. So I said, we're not going to do that anymore. We're going to kill all the bluegrass, and we're going to plant blue grama or buffalo grass. And then in some areas where we think we can get it going, we're going to plant wildflowers and other forbs. So we've done that, and it's been a struggle to get, you know, it's the third year. And so after the first year, it doesn't look very good. Especially in some of the wildflower areas, it takes a couple of years for them to even flower, as I understand it. But we've had some struggles, and we had to overseed a couple times in the grassing areas. And then, of course, you have challenges with flooding and a heavy rain that washes seed out before it gets established. But talk about some of those things that you've encountered and how you deal with that a little bit differently than you might deal with planting a corn crop or soybean or starting something else.
You bet. You want to go first? Okay. I'll just hit a few things that I think Dad and I have struggled with. First of all, I would say one of the things, of course, in my profession, I get exposed to a lot of great things. I have a lot of that knowledge. So one of the things, while I love my dad dearly, one of the things that we had to get through was kind of between his two ears. Because it was different than what he was used to. So I think there's always an education process. It's definitely not a thing where people are necessarily pushing back, I think. It's just education. They just need to learn. And so that was one thing that we dealt with. Competition is difficult. Brome grass and bluegrass are difficult, and you have to get those controlled to get those native plants started. I think next is, you know, finding some resources to help you do some of the seeding. We didn't have a no-till drill. That side hill that we did with the help of Matt's program was extremely fragile. It's pretty much a rock pile. It could make a really good gravel pit, probably. So I did not want to till it, because we would have, the little bit we have gained there soil health-wise, we would set it back. So we had to get no-till equipment. So that's where your local conservation district could come in. Many of them have that equipment that can assist you. We use those. Then I think after that, the next thing is going to be weed control. Right, the thistle, we've done that a lot. I've done a lot of that by hand. Don't want to hurt the pollinators, so how do I take out a thistle plant if I don't want to spray? So it's a corn knife, a shovel, and some of that fun stuff, which is get you out there, and it's good for my body to do that some. And then I think the last part that I'd mention is it's going to take long-term management. It won't stay in that habitat if we don't utilize it and manage it, and so that could be with fire and grazing, and I think those will be the two things that we use. So those are the thoughts that I'd have.
I would echo what Jeff has said, and throw another one in. We talked a little bit about water. About 25% of what we farm right now, both own and rent, is CRP, various programs. And we have actually had a year where we were trying to establish, and it was so dry, it was difficult, and it eventually took 2 to 3 years. The weeds do very well during dry years. The crop did not necessarily want to take a hold, but eventually it did, and we were able to control. And something I can foresee, but it hasn't been a problem yet. And that is sometimes when you try to establish, and I'm not talking specifically about flowers, but some of the grasses, you will get some takeover. And a good thing is wonderful until it becomes too large. And I'll use an example that took place at our home. We live on my wife's family farm. And her mother liked to use natural things, and they had mice in the house. So she decided snakes were their natural enemy. And whenever she saw a snake, she would bring it near the house. Well, when we moved in, it was not uncommon. We would be removing 12 to 15 snakes a week from the basement. There was a point at which we opened the microwave, and right on top there was a snake looking at us. We opened a garage door to drive out, and a snake dropped on our hood. And it just got to the point where we had to do everything we could to move those snakes back out. But they were a wonderful thing to a point. They did control the mice, but it just got to the point where our daughter's first word was snake. So that gives you an idea that things can get out of hand. You just have to have a balance.
Yeah, not mom, not dad, but snake. That's great. Talk about when you've had challenges like this, did any of you work with somebody else to address them, or just from your own personal experience, did you know what to do?
I'll start out on that one. Here's where I went for information and help. And he's right. They have, NRCS has equipment, and that's something that not every farmer has, and it is very helpful. They have advice. They know from experience, and I don't mind arguing with Jeff once in a while, so they are very helpful.
Yeah, and who I went to was other NRCS employees, but then I went to a lot of producers, because those were the folks that had done things before me, and I'd learned a lot from them. So I learned from producers and asked questions, and then also used, you know, the Habitat program and Matt and other people who had done a lot as well. So I think it's like looking at all those things. And I think that's the way these issues are. There's no silver bullets, and none of us are carrying them. And so it's what it means is we all just have to ask questions and start networks and really get discussion going, and the governor talked about that earlier, about that's how we're gonna solve these issues.
Let's talk a little bit about that, Matt. If I'm a producer and I'm thinking, gosh, maybe I'd like to try some pollinators, or maybe I'd like to understand better the benefits of managing the native prairie pasture that I've got already, talk about the Habitat Pays website and the different advisors and how they go about advising someone who maybe has some goals but doesn't know where to start.
That's a great question. So there's, not only does Pheasants Forever have private lands biologists in our state, Audubon has a couple of them, Game Fish and Parks has a few. There's a lot of options out there for landowners to go to talk with individuals that are experienced with it, and you also have Jeff's staff. They're in every county around the state. And I can't stress, like Jeff said, talk to multiple people. Talk to your neighbors. There's some challenges, and everybody's been down that road. But you know, with our staff especially, I can speak to, when a landowner reached out to a farm bill biologist from Pheasants Forever, it's kind of on their schedule. Our staff is very flexible. We go out and meet when the producer can meet with them. We want to make sure that this process is very painless on them. It fits in their schedule. You sit down with that producer and find out, first of all, what's your goal? Is it livestock production? Is it soil health? Is it wildlife? What is that buzzword for that individual, that landowner? Why did they contact us? Then from there, we start building a plan. Whether it's with our programs, Jeff's programs, Fish and Wildlife Service, whatever it is, we want to find that best fit for the producer. A lot of times we'll bring in other professionals to meet with that landowner. I mean, our staff kind of serves as that mediator between everything. I've been walking that producer through every step of the way. And it's from that initial meeting, to start the groundwork, to developing the plans, to implementing them, and then the management on the backside. Because we can't, you know, we sometimes overlook that once the contract gets written, the seed gets in the ground, we forget about the management end of it. And that's probably one of the most important steps, is we're not just going to walk away at that point. None of the Habitat advisors are just going to walk away. They're there for that resource throughout the life of, of the project until something else happens. So we try to be, we use the word one-stop shop, where we're working with producers and we can walk them all the way through that process, because it can be very confusing. You know, Jeff's got 15 programs, we got a bunch of programs, Game of Fish. So there's a lot of options out there and they're all a little bit different. So we just really try to help them through that process, and so do the other private lands biologists around the state.
Very good. Let's talk a little bit about someone that's getting something established. Now, I'm wondering, what is the management of a pollinator plot going to look like? You know, I've heard you talk about burning it, heard you talking about grazing it. Can you mow it too? Is that a good management practice? How often do you have to do that? How often should you, or how many years should you avoid doing anything? What does the management look like?
Boy, I'm going to say there's probably a whole lot of people in this room that are more knowledgeable than I, and Matt's probably, and Jerry is. But I'll just tell you some of the things that we talk about. All of those tools you used are great ones. I think that anything that you can do, if one of your goals is to improve the health of the soil as well, anything you can do to leave that biomass that's grown there on the landscape will be better. So that means that if you can graze it, and take some off with the cow, but then the cow puts something back, which is really productive, and also trample some of that down, that's good. You wouldn't want to do repeated haying where you remove the vegetation from the landscape, but haying can be a tool. Burning can be a tool, but burning it's complex. It's dangerous. You have to be smart. You have to have the tools. You're going to need some help and things like that. And I know Dad and I have been out there many times, and he's thought that we better call the fire department. And I've just told him, no, it'll be okay. We have a plan here. You stay on the tractor with the water, and I'll keep doing my thing. But all of those things have to kind of come together and work together. Matt, you might have some other talk.
Yeah, I can just add a little bit to that. With management, one of the big things is on the front end. You want to make sure, that's the one thing you can control, is the work you do before you put that seed in the ground. You want to make sure that you're going into a good seed bed, addressing some of that weed issue on the front end, using like Roundup Ready soybeans for a couple years prior to seeding it, things like that, so you can go into that best condition possible, because that's the one thing that you as a landowner can control, is that front end. And from there, after you do that, I personally have really good luck, as the more I'm understanding it, is the cattle end of it. Fire is great, but there's a lot of problems with that. And with livestock, you get the benefits of your producing beef, but then also in that hoof action that Jeff talked about is dispersing those seeds. Something to keep in mind with native plants is that's how they evolved, with buffalo and things like that. So they need that livestock to move that seed around. You're actually taking the seed you planted and multiplying it at that point. So I like using cattle as my main tool is in those first few years of really working that soil around and taking care of the weeds and moving some more seed in the ground. I've had a lot of luck with that.
Talk about, what about the frequency of a management practice like that? How frequently would you put your livestock out into your pollinator plot? You do that every year or every 5 years or what?
And that's where a plan's so important, is every site's a little bit different. And typically for what I've seen works the best on most sites is those first couple of years is a lot more intense. Every year you're going in there and grazing it or doing something to it every year for the first 2-3 years. And once that really gets going, then you can start dialing it back to every 3 years or so before you really need to get in there. But every site's a little bit different, the front end's a lot more intense, and as it gets more mature. That's what I've seen. Jeff, you might.
And I was just going to say, and Jerry might have comments with this, but this is where I have learned so much from producers. So I was blessed just 3 weeks ago now, I think, we got to go see Gary Kamak, the ranch. They were this year's Leopold Award winner. And the first site that we went to, you in the room, I got to go there. I know Larry was there. And we walked out on a site, and what Gary and the family were telling the group is that their plan was that they were grazing their rangeland intensively, putting more cows in a smaller area, not there a long time, and then they weren't coming back for at least 365 days, a year. And the site we walked out on, as they described it, was not in the best of health when they started this, and now we've seen a lot of good vegetation on that site, pollinators on that site. So just the work they've done with their grazing system. So I think while every site's different and every site almost needs its own prescription, I think that what a lot of grassland producers are learning is use it pretty intensely, and then rest. And then come back and use it more intensely. And you can do those same things on the same acres. It'll just take a little higher level of management. Jerry, any other thoughts?
Very good. Now, I've been dominating all the questions. What questions do we have from the audience, if any? And if you don't, I'll jump in with some more. But would anyone like to ask a question from the audience?
I'd be interested in knowing if any of you have an end game. What percentage of the habitat should be in pollinators? Any clue?
Boy, I'm gonna take us a ways out, and maybe too far out. And hopefully, when I take us way out there, I don't scare you all. But I got to listen to a producer this week, and he was from northeast Iowa. And he came and he spoke, and he's way out there. He's an innovator. What he's doing is in his normal row crop farming practices, he's integrating pollinators in, I would almost say, on every acre. So if I said to you, I think pollinators should be on every acre, you guys are going to start to think Zimprich needs to retire soon. But the point I'm making is he's doing it in a system that's working well for him. And he's planting diverse crops. He's using cover crops. He's improving the health of his soil. He is improving his bottom line. He's making profit happen on the landscape. He's raising multiple crops. And he's seeing great benefit to pollinators while he's raising those crops. So I actually think that in some ways, and you know, Jerry, with your work with the Soybean Association, one thing that we know is we can improve soybean yields if we can pollinate them better with bees, and there's work being done on that. So why can't we almost look at a soybean field as a pollinator plot and maybe have some other edges in areas that are not really producing those economic benefits that the soybean, some of the good acres, the good land is producing? I'd say I don't think we need to have every acre, but I do think that don't let our minds limit us that it should be just a certain amount. Jerry, you've thought about that some, I'm sure.
I do. And I'm in the early portion of this game. But as we take a world view, things have really changed, most things for the better, but we haven't always paid attention to the impacts that those changes have made. To give you an example, most people don't stop to think that we're losing roughly 160 acres per minute in the world to urban development. How much could we be doing, and I'm not saying this isn't ag's problem, but we share in it, but urban folks could also be doing some of this. Matt has mentioned he's got beehives. And so if we can assist in partnering together to help develop urban areas into doing some of these same things, it'll just be a benefit to us all.
Other questions?
Please talk about some best practices for pesticide applications to protect the bees.
Okay, I'll take a stab at it. I think the most important thing is, number one, what's your issue? Have you reached an economic threshold with that issue, that insect, that concern that you have? It may not be an insect, it could be a weed. Both, I think, are equally important. If you've reached that economic threshold where it's going to make good sense to spray, is it your entire field or is it a portion of your field? Can you target? I think those are the main principles that we at NRCS would talk about all the time when we talk about pesticide management. Scouting, knowing what's going on. Where is the issue? Has it reached an economic threshold? And then, can I spot treat it? So We've all, or several of us, have talked about Canadian thistle. We have Canadian thistle on these areas that I showed you. And so far, what I've been doing to manage that pest is we've been trying to keep it mowed off so it doesn't go to seed. The second thing I'm going to do is I'm going to try to have biological control come in. Dad's been trying to use chemical control for many years and just has not really succeeded. So we're going to try to see if biological control might work. Some of the flies, the galls, and some of those critters might be able to help us out. But I think the key is just go into it with a really open view. We hear a lot on our rangeland that some producers will do just broadcast spraying. You know, sometimes it'll be aerial, sometimes it would be with a ground machine. Again, if you don't have the issue all over, save those dollars, target, spot spray, do those kinds of things would be what hits me. Any other thoughts?
From the farmer perspective, pest management is just extremely important. And not only for this year, but we try to keep track of every particular field, the types of insects or weeds that we have, and try to manage them before it becomes a problem. And sometimes that means maybe using a particular crop that will guarantee we don't have to spray, or at least assist us in not spraying as much so we don't reach that threshold. It's pretty important to do that. And one of the promises that I made to the individual that I partnered with for having the beehives was that I would ensure that no neonicotinoids would be used close to the bees. And I don't have a problem with that. We can manage it. It takes a little more management, but the return is wonderful.
I think another big part of it is education of, just because it's not a grass, that doesn't mean it's a weed. We need to really learn about that whole system as a whole, how it functions together. A lot of times our knee-jerk reaction is I need to get out there and I need to just treat it all. And not really, like you said, look at the economic thresholds of it and what those plants actually are. A lot of times we see cases of native thistles and things like that are actually very beneficial to the soils. And livestock like them and that kind of stuff, but they get lumped into that all thistles bad category. So there's some of that. We're meeting with people and finding out what's out there. We can kind of decide if there is a problem there or not. Their thing is looking at, we fall back on what we know, Roundup, 2,4-D, that kind of stuff. And there's some other chemicals out on the market that you apply like in the fall. You know, thistle's a biannual plant. We'll mow it because we see that seed head and that flower coming on. But in reality, the real issue for next year is sitting down at ground level in that rosette stage, and we miss that. So a management plan where you're mowing during the summer to take care of that flowering plant that's producing that seed that year, but then not forgetting about it in the fall and coming in with another chemical and doing a fall application when your native plants and stuff have went dormant, so you're not going to impact them as much, and you can minimize your risks. I mean, you can do stuff like that on those patches of thistle that are really bad. Just doing it a little bit differently and taking the time to talk with folks and formulating a little different plan because it is a different monster out there. So,
other questions? Over here. Yeah.
Great presentation, by the way. It was really, really good by all the presenters. I really think you guys did a great job. But I'm wondering, is there a kind of an ambassadors program out there to help spread the word about pollinator habitats? I mean, I'd like to be able to, you know, in local communities to be able to spread it so that the word, so that there's more and more of those producers that are, you know, setting aside some land to create those habitats and whatnot. And I just wondered what's the best resource to go to try to kind of create an ambassador program?
I think it's a super idea, and I don't think there's an exact fit. But I do think we would have a spinoff, and that is that we know that producers learn better from other producers, right? You are the folks that are on the horses and in the tractor seats, and you are going to learn way better from you than you're going to from somebody with the U.S. government who's, you know, I'm from the government and I'm here to help you. So a few years ago, with that in mind and the large push in the interest in soil health, we created this network called South Dakota Voices for Soil Health. It now numbers over 120 producers from across our state that are willing to share their time, their information, their knowledge with other producers, and they're available. We're taking that group, we're putting them into a mentoring brochure right now. We're preparing that with the South Dakota Grassland Coalition, the Soil Health Coalition, and other partners. Maybe there could be a part of that program that has an emphasis on pollinators. So we have people that have said we want to start a voices program for people that want to do no-till gardening or real healthy gardening. There's the ranching side. There's the crop side. I think there's a lot of interaction. A lot of our producers do all of those things. So maybe there could be just a subsection on pollinators. Maybe that's something we need to think on. But it could be also a way, Governor, I don't know if there would be a way for the state to create almost like an award program for producers that are doing amazing things with pollinators and share that and carry that on. There are conservation award programs now that can be used. The Division of Soil Conservation, Bill Smith and his shop has one of those programs that could be used. So those are the initial things that hit. What could we do from the industry side?
Boy, wonderful question. I guess the first thing that comes to mind for me is anytime you try to establish something new, it always goes better with young people. And so I don't know if there's anybody from FFA in here familiar. Do they have a pollinator program? Or I guess I would throw that out for 4-H and FFA. Get those folks interested because they are the next generation.
Maybe we should ask Mariah. She's a current chair of the SDSU Farm Bureau Club, correct? So maybe that's a challenge to her. We won't put her too bad on the spot. Matt, maybe you have some thoughts. Maybe the governor has some ideas.
Yeah, I think it's a great concept that we need to be working on because I've seen it time and again where we'll meet with the producer, but they're always going to go to their neighbors and the people they're comfortable with for that last advice. And if we can get a network of producers out there that people can go to, I think it's a phenomenal idea, and I think, you know, we'll all on this panel work on setting something up like that we can form that coalition for landowners to use.
Governor? Yeah, and from the governor's side, I think it does make sense to maybe have the Department of Ag could create some sort of a conservation award for pollination or pollinator plot establishment. And it seems to me that if we can continue discussions like this, panel discussions like this, not just at the Ag Summit, but other producer group meetings, when producers are coming together in large groups, get permission to do a little bit of a dog and pony show, just like we did today, and then hope the word spreads that way. That'd be another approach. We are out of time, but I do want to ask everyone to help me thank our panel members for their great time and presentation today.